which is the community group that is sponsoring tonight's event. Repair is a group of Westchester citizens of every background who have come together out of concern for racial inclusion and justice. We meet once a month to share our stories, to learn from one another and from invited guests, and to explore ways that we can support community organizations that are working on behalf of racial healing and fairness. I invite you to take one of our flyers from the women's side, where we'll be having the reception after our presentation this evening. Also in the room where the reception is held, you'll find that books will be on sale by our special guest tonight. They're $33. They are taking credit cards, so there's really no excuse. Do take a repair flyer, sign up for our e-newsletter, and we hope you'll join us at a future event, and you can also friend us on Facebook.
If you have an empty seat next to you, could you raise your hand, because there are people coming in that need seats. Okay, so there's seats in the back.
And there are some seats way in the back. And there's some seats. On the side. It's wonderful to have a problem.
We all want to hear this. I didn't raise my hand.
So tonight is a very special evening, and I want to thank a few people who made it possible. Several repair members have played a crucial role, as always, on things like logistics and technology and publicity and most important snacks. I'll especially mention Janice Landrum, Gwen Fair, and Jenny Lachlan, all of whom played important roles. I also want to thank Steve Dillard and the Peekskill NAACP who have provided a video crew to capture tonight's event, so those who weren't able to attend will be able to watch excerpts or perhaps the whole thing on a link online, which we'll have shortly. Also want to thank the staff of the Village Bookstore in Pleasantville who are making books available for purchase and autographing. And of course, the Warner Library, which is this wonderful community resource which makes events like this possible throughout the year. So let me tell you a little bit about tonight's speaker. Dr. Ibram X Kendi describes himself this way, a hardcore humanist and softcore vegan, who enjoys joking it up with friends and family, partaking in African-American culture, weightlifting, reading provocative nonfiction books, discussing the issues of the day with open-minded people, which includes everyone here, I hope, and also hoping for the day the New York Knicks will win an NBA championship, and for the day this nation and world will be ruled by the best of humanity. For the word optimist, you see a picture of that. Kendi was born in 1982 to parents who came of age during the Black Power Movement in New York City and became student activists and Christians inspired by Black liberation theology. Kendi attended Florida A&M University, where he earned his undergraduate degrees in journalism and African American studies. After working for a time as a journalist, he earned his doctoral degree in African American Studies from Temple University in 2010, and he's now a professor at the University of Florida. Kendi's first book, The Black Canvas Movement, Black Students and the Racial Reconstitution of Higher Education, was published in March 2012. His second book, Stamped from the Beginning, The Definitive History of Racist Ideas in America, was published by Nation Books in 2016, and won that year's National Book Award for Nonfiction. So now please join me in welcoming to the stage Dr. Ibram X. Kendi.
Presumably more broadly, to have an open-minded conversation about some issues that we've been dealing with, right, as a nation, especially for the last few years, but I would argue from the beginning of this country. And so again, it's truly an honor for me to be here. And so what I'd like to do is I only want to sort of talk for about 30 minutes, and then we will have plenty of time for questions and commentary. And I first want to sort of begin with a story, and then I'm going to sort of present to you from that story the underlying thesis, or what was my major finding of Stanford. Like, after studying nearly 600 years of racist ideas, what did I learn? And then I want to read from you a few excerpts from the book, and then I'm going to provide some closing thoughts. Is that okay? Okay. So, in 1840, the United States engaged in taking its census. And this was the first U.S. census that used or recorded people as insane. And 3 years before the 1840 census, John C. Calhoun, anybody heard of John C. Calhoun? So of course he's been in the news recently, right? He's not living like Frederick Douglass. He's been in the news recently, of course, about controversy at Yale. And in 3 years before, in 1837, John C. Calhoun went before his colleagues and heard one of his colleagues from Virginia in the U.S. Senate talking about slavery as a necessary evil, which was largely the line of thought that had defended slavery since the time of Thomas Jefferson. And that line of thinking was largely under assault by the abolitionist movement in the 1830s. The abolitionist movement that was proclaiming and demonstrating the way in which slavery was actually an unnecessary evil. So they kept the word evil, but of course, reframed whether it was necessary. And so John C. Calhoun saw this booming abolitionist movement, largely propelled by Christians, that was challenging and showing the ways in which slavery was evil and unnecessarily evil. And so in 1837, he stood before the Senate and said, "No, Virginia slaveholder, slavery is not a necessary evil. Slavery is a positive good. It's a positive good for black people. It's a positive good for America." Yeah, he actually can say it. And so in 1840, again, you know, the United States went about recording its census, went about recording insane people. And a few years later, Edward Jarvis, who was a Harvard-trained psychiatrist, looked very closely at the insanity data from this census, and looked specifically at the insanity data and its correlation to race, and its correlation to free status. And he found that black people were 10 times more likely to be insane in the free North than in the enslaved South. And he published his findings, as well as his analysis of those findings, in 1843 in the New England Journal of Medicine. Anybody know anything about the New England Journal of Medicine? It's the most prestigious medical journal in the world. It was then and remains so today. His analysis was that, I guess, slavery must be having a good effect on black people because freedom is literally driving them insane. And of course, John C. Calhoun and other positive good theorists saw this article in the most prestigious medical journal in the world and started waving it and saying, "You see, we have proof. We have scientific, empirical proof that slavery is a positive good for black people, for America." And so Edward Jarvis started looking closer at the data, as scholars should do, right? And he began to find some problems. He began to realize that in some northern towns, there were more black insane people than there were black residents. Let me say that again. He found in some towns there were more black insane people than black residents. Now, it doesn't take a math PhD. He was one of the pioneering statisticians in America, was very prominent in the founding of the American Statistical Association. But it doesn't take a rocket science to know that something doesn't add up, right? And so he and some of the other sort of founders of the American Statistical Association began lobbying Congress to investigate the census, specifically its insanity figures, because there's something must be wrong here, right? And by the time Congress got around to investigating, John C. Calhoun was the Secretary of State, who at the time oversaw the census. So I'm sure everybody could understand what John C. Calhoun did. He did an investigation in quotes, right, and found that there was nothing wrong with the census of 1840. And if anything, it proved what I had been saying since 1837, that slavery is good for black people, that it took them out of the barbarism of Africa and it's now civilizing them. They've learned all of these different things. And it's also, of course, good for America, because in order to have a stable nation, we must have inequality. That's the argument, right? And so, like, this story is one of the many stories that I present in STEM from the beginning. And it is a story that caused me to sort of rethink the way in which we understand the history of racism in America, or more specifically, the development of racist ideas. So positive good theory was a racist idea. Everybody can understand the ways in which that was a racist idea. And I went into the writing of this book thinking that the real source of racist ideas that suggest that there's something wrong or inferior about black people, that the real source of racist ideas was ignorance and hate. That these producers of racist ideas, these powerful, influential producers of racist ideas, were just ignorant. They just didn't know any better. I thought that they just hated black people. You know, by the time I started writing the Jefferson section, I realized that that wasn't true. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Right. And yes, Sally, right. But we have been taught, right, that this sort of, the source of racist ideas is ignorance and hate. So then people sort of develop these racist ideas out of ignorance and hate. And then it's these people with these racist ideas who are the people who institute or even defend racist policies. That's the line of thinking we've largely been taught. And so what I actually ended up doing in writing STEM from the beginning is I wanted to investigate the hypothesis that has largely been taught to us for a very long time. And the way I ended up doing it is, first and foremost, I distinguished between the producers of racist ideas and the consumers. So John C. Calhoun was a producer of racist ideas. His constituents, for instance, and other people throughout America who came to believe that slavery was good for black people are the consumers of racist ideas. The book writers are the producers of racist ideas. Those who read them are consumers. The people who make the speeches, right, or make the films, like, these are the people who circulate ideas. These were the people that I studied in STEM from the beginning. And I asked over and over again, like, why were they producing these ideas? And I didn't take for granted it was because they were ignorant and hateful. I wanted to figure out if that was true. I wanted to figure out the motives. I wanted to understand the historical context. I gave the example of John C. Calhoun's positive good theory emerging in 1837 on the backdrop of this massive abolitionist movement that was demonstrating the way in which slavery was unnecessarily evil. Like, that's the sort of example of the historical context in which idea is emerging. And I found over and over again that the people who were producing these ideas were some of the most brilliant American minds. And oftentimes, they loved black people. At least they thought they did. And I found over and over again that these people were producing racist ideas to defend existing racist policies, to normalize racial inequality, to make you and I believe that black people and their inferiorities are the cause of racial inferiority instead of racist policies. And why were racist policies so central to them, so important to them? Because they benefited from it. And so really the source of racism, or I should say racist policies, has generally been self-interest, economic, political, and cultural. And then people have created racist ideas to justify those racist policies. And then they've circulated those racist ideas, and then that's caused us to become ignorant and evil. So that's the sort of history that I tell, by again focusing on the producers of racist ideas and understanding the context in which their ideas emerged. And we should, everybody in this room who's been following, everyone in this room who's been following American politics, especially American voting politics, should see and be able to understand this sort of actual line of thinking. Right? What came first? The self-interest of a particular party to maintain power in state legislatures, in Congress, or even to gain the White House, though that particular party recognized that ideologically and demographically, the nation was heading away from them. So when you don't have the votes, what do? You suppress the votes. That's advanced politics, right? You suppress the votes. So then what do? How do you suppress the votes? You figure out a way to create new policies that suppress the votes. But of course, you can't say, oh, I want to suppress black people's votes or senior citizens' votes or students' votes, right? You have to figure out a way to target those groups without putting language in those actual laws, right? And so, of course, some judges have recognized the ways in which voter ID laws have targeted, quote, black people with precision. And then, what do? You have to create a justification for those laws. You have to create a rationale for those laws. That rationale is voter fraud. That rationale is voter fraud. And then, when people present to you indisputable evidence that voter fraud is a non-issue, do you say, oh, I didn't know that? No. You're like, no, actually, voter fraud is even worse than I was saying before. Right, and that should show that the people creating these ideas are not creating them out of thing. They know precisely that voter fraud is not a problem. And then they circulate this idea of voter fraud and attach that to the populations that they're suppressing, namely black people. And then the racist, the long-held racist idea of the corrupt black voter reemerges in American politics, compelling some Americans to grab their guns and go up to black polling sites to eliminate, quote, black voter fraud. These are consumers of racist ideas. And then for those very people to clamor for even more voter ID laws and voter suppression laws, which will suppress those votes. Right? That's essentially what has happened throughout the history of racist ideas. This racist idea of the corrupt black voter, right, emerging within a context in which people were trying to substantiate a policy that benefited them. And so I show that over and over again throughout American history. And I should also say very briefly that in Stamped the Beginning, actually chronicle a three-way debate about race in America. And we've largely been taught this debate about, this debate between racist and non-racist, and, or racist ideas and non-racist ideas. I actually chronicle a three-way debate, each of which I have a term for. The first line of thinking is called a segregationist idea. The second line of thinking is called an assimilationist idea. And the third line of thinking is called an anti-racist idea. And each of these positions have sought to explain why racial inequities exist in American society. And each of these positions have a different answer. And as everybody would imagine, you know, since almost the founding of colonial America, there was racial inequality, especially since the founding of the United States. So then you've had Americans trying to explain, why is it that so many black people are enslaved and white people free? Why is it that black people are segregated on the poorer side of town? Why is it that we have 2 million black people in prison? Why is it that over the last 50 years, the black unemployment rate has been twice as high as the white unemployment rate? Why is it that white people have 15 times more wealth in this country than black people? Why is it that 40% of the incarcerated population in this country is black, even though black people represent about 13% of the population? Why does this nation have these racial inequities, these racial disparities? There are only three positions. There's long been three positions trying to explain the existence of these racial disparities. The segregationist position has long blamed black inferiorities. And historically, segregationists have stated that black people are biologically inferior and thereby permanently inferior. And thereby they've imagined a nation of permanent inequality. Anti-racists have said that the racial groups are equal. And so therefore the cause of racial inequities is racial discrimination. And despite the differences, the cultural differences and even the aesthetic differences of racial groups, they're still equal. That we can imagine differences being equal. And they also clamor for immediate equality. And assimilationist ideas have been a little tricky. Basically, assimilationists have stood in the middle of segregationist and anti-racist ideas. Historically, assimilationists have said, you know what, the racial groups are actually biologically equal. We're created equal. But over time, black people became inferior. Their inferiority is not the result of nature, as segregationists would say. Their inferiority is a result of nurture. Either their inferior culture, whether that culture is an Africa or African-American culture, or their environment, meaning even their oppressive environment. Like slavery, not only was dehumanizing, assimilationists would say, it literally made black people into brutes. Segregation was not just oppressive. It literally made black people into subhumans. Poverty isn't just an oppressive institution. It is literally making poor people lazy and all of these other behavioral traits. And so what we need to do, assimilationists would say, is of course fight against racial discrimination. Not only because racial discrimination is bad, because it has literally made black people inferior. Now, segregationist ideas of black biological inferiority has never been proven, and recently has been soundly disproven. But even assimilationist ideas have never been proven, and are based on a series of cultural subjectivities, misleading statistics, or outright lies. And anti-racists have said, you know what, the racial groups are not only created equal, they are equal. That yes, slavery, poverty, segregation, mass incarceration was and is dehumanizing. But it did not make black people inferior. It made their opportunities inferior. It made their resources inferior. And so this has been the three-way debate over the course of American history. Right? One group saying black people are permanently inferior. The segregationist ideas, assimilationist saying black people are temporarily inferior, but we have the capacity to civilize and develop them. So we should do that as well as challenge racial discrimination. And anti-racists who say, no, actually, black people are already civil. And what racial justice activists need to do is fight racial discrimination. There's nothing wrong with black people. All they need is opportunities. And so I'm going to stop there and read a few passages. Is that okay? Yes. Oh, I'll do two passages. So I, the book is organized into five sections, and each section has a major character. And each major character sort of serves as like this sort of window to this larger three-way debate I just described. And the first chapter, the major character is a minister by the name of Cotton Mather. Anybody heard of Cotton Mather?
Yeah.
You may learn a little bit, some things that you didn't know about Cotton Mather by reading this text. And I knew both of my parents are ministers. And I was quite concerned about what they would think about this section, but they actually loved it more than anything because I think they learned in many ways about the history of Christianity that they didn't know, a dual history of Christianity. A Christianity seeking to enslave black people and a Christianity seeking to free them. So this passage is taken from the first section, and it's taken from a chapter called Black Hunts. How many doleful wretches have been decoyed into witchcraft? Cotton Mather asked in 1691. His father increased. Preached a lengthy series on devils in 1693 after returning from England with the new Massachusetts charter. Samuel Parris, a Salem minister, preached endlessly about the devils in their midst. And on one dismal day in February of 1692, Parris anxiously watched his 9-year-old daughter and 11-year-old niece suffer chokes, convulsions, and pinches. As their conditions worsened each day, the minister's worsened too. It dawned on Paris, the girls had been bewitched. While prayers rose up like kites in Salem and nearby towns, the Salem witch hunt began. The number of afflicted and accused spread over the next few months, swelling the public uproar and turning public attention from political to religious strife. And in nearly every instance, the devil, who was preying upon innocent white Puritans, was described as black. One Puritan accuser described the devil as a, quote, little black bearded man, end quote. Another saw a, quote, black thing of considerable bigness. A big thing jumped in one man's window. Quote, the body was like that of a monkey, the observer added. The feet like a cock's, but the face much like a man's. Since the devil represented criminality, and since criminals in New England were said to be the devil's operatives, the Salem witch hunt ascribed a black face to criminality, an ascription that remains to this day. Anybody hear that type of, that side of the Salem witch trial? This second passage is from the third section of the text. So the second major character is somebody by the name of Thomas Jefferson. You may have heard of him. The third section, the major character is William Lloyd Garrison. William Lloyd Garrison was, of course, the most famous white male abolitionist. And the most famous white female abolitionist was, of course, Harriet Beecher Stowe. titled Uncle Tom's Cabin, Stowe's living dramatic reality entered bookstores on March 20th, 1862. The scenes of this story, she opened the novel's preface, lie among an exotic race whose character was so essentially unlike the hard and dominant Anglo-Saxon race. In black people's low docility of heart, their aptitude to repose on a superior mind and rest on a higher power, their childlike simplicity of affection and facility of forgiveness, she wrote, in all these they will exhibit the highest form of a peculiarly Christian life. Only enslavement was holding them back. In one novel, Stowe ingeniously achieved what Garrison had been trying to do for roughly two decades, in article after article in The Liberator. For the cosmic shift to anti-slavery, Stowe did not ask Americans to change their deep-seated beliefs. She only asked him to alter the implications, the meaning of their deep-seated beliefs. Stowe met Americans where they were, in the concrete of racist ideas. She accepted the nationally accepted premise of the enslaver. Naturally docile and intellectually inferior black people were disposed to their enslavement to white people, and Stowe crucially tacked on to God. Stowe inverted Cotton Mather in all those preachers after him who had spent years trying to convince planters that Christianity made blacks better slaves. She claimed that since docile blacks made the best slaves, they made the best Christians. Since domineering whites made the worst slaves, they made the worst Christians. Stowe offered Christian salvation to white America through anti-slavery. In order to become better Christians, white people must constrain their domineering temperament, she argued, and end the evil outgrowth of that temperament, slavery. The relations of Tom and Eva sit at this novel's thematic center. Stowe created the double character, the naturally Christian Tom and Eva. Eva, of course, was a little girl, to highlight her conception of blacks being more feminine, docile, childlike, and affectionate, I'm quoting her, which allows Christianity to find a, quote, more congenial atmosphere in black lives. In a major proselytizing battle, Stowe pits the soulful Christian black sage, Tom, against the mindful, unchristian white master, St. Clair. Quote, thou hast hid from the wise and prudent and revealed unto babes, Tom says in biblical style. Stowe maintained this spiritual superiority allowed blacks to have soul. Stowe's popularization of spiritually gifted black people quickly became a central pillar of African-American identity as black readers consumed the book and passed on its racist ideas. Racist whites, believing themselves to be void of soul, made it their personal mission to find soul through black people. Racist blacks, believing themselves to be void of intellect, made it their personal mission to find intellect through white people. Black Americans almost immediately made Uncle Tom the identifier of black submissiveness while accepting Stowe's underlying racist idea that made Uncle Tom so submissive. Blacks were especially spiritual. They especially had soul. And finally, William Lloyd Garrison revered Uncle Tom in his book review on March 26, 1852. But he was virtually alone in his anti-racist questioning of Stowe's religious bigotry. Quote, is there one law of submission and non-resistance for the black man and another law of rebellion and conflict for the white man? Are there two Christs? And then finally, I heard that one of the issues of bigotry that people in this community are dealing with is the attacks on Jewish community centers. And I wanted to read a passage from Stand from the Beginning to show, as I talk about in more so in the epilogue, and I sort of chronicle throughout the book, the interlocking nature of many different bigotries. In that, you know, bigotries against different groups literally feed on each other. And so even if you are not black, bigotry against black people, which of course we call racism, feeds the type of bigotry that you may have experienced in your life. So this passage comes from the fourth section, and this is the last passage I'll read, comes from the fourth section, and the major character in this section was W.E.B. Du Bois. And as this sort of section talks about the rise of the eugenics movement, a movement in the early 1900s, largely inspired by social Darwinism, that suggested that, first and foremost, that there's a relationship between genes and behavior, and genes and behavior in groups. And certain groups were genetically superior to other groups, and thereby genetically intellectually inferior. And these eugenicists did not just rank order whites over blacks. They ranked order Anglo-Saxons over Jews, Anglo-Saxons over Italians. They ranked order men over women, middle-income people over poor people, rich people over middle-income people, right? I'm sure they rank order people who live in New York City as more superior to people who live here, right? You know, there are all different types of rank orders. And this hierarchy, this massive human hierarchy that eugenicists created, in their mind, as segregationists, was permanent. Eugenicists promoting the need for maintaining the purity of the white race endlessly berated interracial reproduction. In an explosive wartime book, in 1916, called The Passing of the Great Race. Does that sound familiar to anybody? It's the inversion of something that we all know, right? Published in 1916, called The Passing of the Great Race, New York lawyer Madison Grant constructed a racial ethnic ladder with Nordics, the new term for Anglo-Saxons, at the top, and Jews, Italians, the Irish, Russians, and all non-whites on lower rungs. He reconstructed a world history of rising and falling civilizations based on the, quote, amount of Nordic blood in each nation. The races vary intellectually and morally just as they do physically, Grant suggested. It has taken us 50 years to learn that speaking English, wearing good clothes, and going to school and church does not transform a Negro into a white man. This segregationist passionately told assimilationists that their efforts were bound to fail, because of course assimilationists were trying to what? Civilize black people. Black people were incapable of development and could never become white. Grant revised and reissued his book 3 times in 5 years, and it was translated into several foreign languages. Publishers were barely able to supply the voracious demand for segregationist ideas and for the dashing eugenics movement as white theorists attempted to normalize the social inequities of the day. When Germany surrendered in the Great War, an embittered Austrian soldier sprinted into German politics, where he gained some cheers for his nasty speeches against Marxists and Jews. In 1924, Adolf Hitler was jailed for an attempted revolution. He used the time in prison and Madison Grant's book to write his magnum opus, Mein Kampf. The highest aim of human existence is the conservation of race, Hitler famously wrote. The Nazi czar later thanked Grant for writing The Passing of the Great Race, which Hitler called, quote, my Bible. So in closing, I just want to say that despite reading many, many pages on racist ideas, and even more on the effects of these racist ideas on everyday people, you know, I'm still actually quite hopeful. And what has made me hopeful has, I think, first and foremost, been my ability to chronicle not only racist ideas in Stanford Meeting, but anti-racist ideas. For me to show that really at every period in American history, you had Americans of all races who were challenging these notions of racial inequality, and who were challenging these systems and policies that created racial inequality. And it is these people who continue to sort of give me hope. I also know that philosophically, you have to believe that change is possible in order to bring it about. And cynicism is actually the kryptonite of change. And so I understand philosophically the importance of being optimistic and hopeful, but then I also recognize and allow myself to recognize, I should say, all of these anti-racist activists and thinkers in history who have constantly challenged and are continuing to challenge racism in this country. And these people are the people, again, who give me hope. And I would advise and suggest and hope that they would, that you would allow them to give you hope too. Thank you. Is that if you look at the historical events and even the thinkers themselves, they were typically creating, and again, it's the creation of new racist ideas because of their own self-interest or because they were seeking to defend existing racist policies that typically were being assaulted by historical events or even anti-racist activists. I would also say very quickly that I don't typically like talking about this thesis, especially among sort of smart people, because it doesn't really make logical sense in certain types of ways. But it makes sense after you've read the whole book.
I'm not sure the whole book gets this, the problem. So, but just one other part, are you saying that racist ideas never come before racist policies?
I wouldn't say never. I mean, as a historian, you know, you, or a scientist, you never say never. However, again, what, like, let's take a particular, you take any major idea about black people. You know, you pick one, I can tell you its origins, and I can tell you the social historical context in which it emerged. I can tell you what was influencing the person to basically create that idea. And I can tell you the way that they benefited from the creation of the idea. And I can presumably suggest the ways in which they may not even believe that idea themselves.
Okay, I'll read the rest of
those. Yes.
So what
administration.
So you said, why are they doing?
Why are they perpetuating things that, you know, I mean, I'm an LGBT activist. I thought we were been there, done that in many respects. I can't get over what I'm hearing out of Washington about African Americans and LGBTs and women and reproductive issues. It's the end game.
So I think, it's hard, of course, to say the end game, but what I can say is that I think our traditional sort of history that we have been taught has failed to explain the current moment. And what I'm referring to is that we have been taught this history, and I can say it very definitively about racism, but I think it's the case with bigotry more broadly. We've been taught this sort of singular, sort of marching history of progress. And that, you know, when we have problems, we sort of take two steps back, but it's fundamentally been a force of forward progress. That's what Obama made the case for in his final speech. And I argue, and I show in Stamp at the beginning, that there's actually been two historical forces. There's been a force of racial progress, but then there's been a simultaneous progression of racism, a second historical force. So there's been the anti-racist progress and racist progress. And if Obama represents or personifies racial progress or the progress against bigotry, then you know what Donald Trump personifies, right? And we should also know that historically, and of course this is generally speaking, when activists have broken down barriers, those who created and benefited from those barriers, you know, did not go home and go to sleep, right? They created new barriers, more sophisticated barriers. That's the progression, it's more sophisticated. And they created even more sophisticated racist ideas or bigoted ideas to then justify those policies, to cause us to not see those policies because we're blaming black people or people of color or the LGBT community or whoever is at the lower end of that disparity because of these newly sophisticated ideas. And so that's the sort of, and so you have these two historical forces at war for the soul of America.
Can you share with us some titles of books that you read that really moved you through the years?
It's hard.
Or authors.
So I think Autobiography of Malcolm X, of course. Fatal Invention, which is a book on that really shows the ways in which our conceptions of this relationship between genes and race is simply not true. It was a very critical book, I think, for my own development in recognizing there's no relationship between genes and races. Another book, of course, The New Jim Crow, which I think is quite important. Of course, I mean, Zora Neale Hurston, James Baldwin. You know, I think I've read many of the, I think, books that people have read in this room, hopefully.
Yes. It seems like both the creators and the consumers of racism achieve some benefits from it, but they're very different.
Mm-hmm.
And the consumers obviously reap the most benefits. And I think the consumers do too, reap some benefits. But they also suffer.
Yes.
And it seems like part of the challenge is to convince that at some level, the consumers are also being hurt by these policies. How do you convince them that the little benefit they get doesn't outweigh the damage that it does?
So, at the end of the book, I distinguish between what I classify as intelligent self-interest versus unintelligent self-interest. And the role that racist ideas has played historically, it has caused many people to think that it is in their intelligent self, it is in their self-interest to support, let's say, racism, to support racist policies. And in fact, it's been in their unintelligent self. Like, you know, it hasn't actually, it's actually in a general sense, to give an example, white people have benefited from racism. Mm-hmm. However, if you start breaking down white people according to class, only a specific group of white people have benefited from racism, and if anything, other groups have, in a general sense, actually not benefited, especially in the last 40 years. You know, we've talked a lot, I think, as racial justice activists, about the ways in which the white poor, like, why would the white poor, like, be voting for a Republican? Like, you know, that's against their own economic self-interest, right? But we haven't spoken as much about the ways in which the white middle class voting for Republicans is against their economic self-interest, which is key, right? We, because of the growing inequality between the white middle class and the white upper class, that has sort of created this sort of door that Bernie Sanders and other income inequality activists has been able to walk through and sort of demonstrate the ways in which, right, American policies over the last 40 years has not benefited people. And it's certainly true. Like, you had many middle-income white people voting for politicians because they had manipulated into thinking that welfare was bad, affirmative action was bad, crime was bad. And these people got into office and cut taxes for the rich, increased the voting beyond the incarcerated population. Then they needed to pay for that, so then they decreased the amount of allotments to public education, specifically higher education, and even public education. Then caused middle-income people of all races to have to start paying more money for their kids, right? I mean, you know, I can go sort of on and on, so I show the ways in which that happens. I mean, even something like we lynching scholars recently have shown the ways in which not only lynching was harmful to the people who were lynched, specifically the black men, but it also constrained the sexuality of white women. Feminist scholars have talked about the ways in which our constructions of the hypersexual black woman is largely placed in opposition to the asexual white woman. Everybody sort of understand that way that works. So that fundamentally denigrates both groups, right? It not only sort of misrepresents the sexuality of black women, right, but it misrepresents the sexuality of white women. Even terms like white trash, which I argue in my work is actually a synonym of the term extraordinary Negro. That what both terms do is it says, when that white person who is poor, who's not as articulate, who's not as powerful, well, no, they're not white, they're white trash. And that black person who is defying stereotypes, oh, they're an extraordinary Negro. They're not like those ordinary inferior black people, which then allows for people to continue to hold their racist ideas in the midst of people in their regular environment defying them every day. I can go on and on, but I know we have more questions. Do you have a question?
I wanted to thank you for mentioning the JCPenney bomb threats from yesterday. You know, as a Jewish woman walking around with a white face in the world, it's a complicated relationship, and being aware of racism in other ways and being a vulnerable minority, but yet also being white in the world creates a weird dynamic. So I just wanted to thank you because it was just another horrible step in bringing what is happening, well, what I believe has been happening with Black people and Latinos and people who are visibly persecuted all the time, is bringing it larger into our immediate sphere, which again we thought was a bubble of safety and justice and fairness. So I appreciate your bringing that in with this. And even while I've been listening to you, I'm like trying to tie in all the pieces of all the different groups that are persecuted and understanding like the essence of why people turn to that place of hatred and like you were saying before about thinking it comes from ignorance, and there's actually, you know, the use of words and ideas to sculpt.
Yeah, I mean, we're fed these ideas from the time we start understanding the world. Another book that I would recommend to your question is The History of White People by Mel Irvin Painter, a Princeton historian. And one of the interesting things that I learned from this book, and I think about it in reference to mine, is really when you think about the intersection of race and ethnicity, that historically, really from the beginning of the time in which people were classifying certain groups as races, they were also classifying ethnic groups. From the beginning of the time in which people were creating a hierarchy of races, they were creating a hierarchy of ethnic groups within those races. So as related to Black people, those Black people who were the most valuable on the slave market were considered, those ethnic groups, like from Senegambia, to give an example, were considered the most superior Black people. While Angolans, who were more prevalent in the supply, were considered the most inferior because they had a lesser sort of demand. And of course, everybody knows, you know, that Jewish people, Romani and others, were considered inferior, Irish. One of the things that's happened that I've seen, and it's been quite interesting, is you had people who basically would say that, you know what, I agree that I and my group isn't superior to all the other people below us on this huge racial ethnic ladder, but I'm not inferior to those people that they say is above. That's what pretty much most people say. So for instance, if an Irish person will say, let's say, oh, I'm superior to Black people, but I'm not inferior to no English people, right? Or like an African American will say, you know what, I'm superior to Nigerians, but I'm not inferior to white people, right? And so what happens is,
like the self-hierarchy.
Yes, so this massive, again, hierarchy, ethnic and racial. So I talk about in the book that what people do is they smack the racist chicken and enjoy its racist eggs.
So I obviously, this is a very secular place, but I'm obviously a Christian minister. How do you see racist ideas playing out in what I would consider to be two sort of revealing ways of making meaning, one the religious sphere and one the sort of secular academic understanding of reason? Is there any way to escape the ways in which racist ideas wrap themselves, the American racialized reality wraps itself around both of those meaning-making institutions? I mean, is there a way for people to participate in them without involving themselves unwittingly in one of the parties they don't want to be a part of, like without being segregationist or assimilationist, by being co-opted into one of these narratives? Since they're so deeply steeped, all of these institutions are deeply steeped in these things, how do we maneuver around them? How do we recognize it? What do we do?
So that's precisely what I really attempted to do with my book, and for people to see within many of these racial debates the anti-racist position. So, to give an example, the first major debate in the history of racist ideas was this debate between what I call climate theory and curse theory. So, everybody heard of curse theory, right? Black people were the cursed descendants of Ham.
Oh, wow.
And thereby they're permanently inferior and they are destined for slavery. That was the first major segregationist idea. And they are a different species of being from, of course, their permanent enslavers who have been blessed by God. And then climate theory was the theory, you think that theory was ridiculous, try this one, was the theory, and again, there's a religious side of it, and then there's a secular side, because really in the, it really wasn't until, as many of you know, the 1800s, somewhere in the early, the mid-1700s with the Enlightenment era, that science became, you know, a secular sort of enterprise, right? You know, theologians were scientists in the 1500s and 1600s. So climate theorists made the case that, of course, God was white, Adam and Eve were white, and the Garden of Eden was in Europe. And at some point, the descendants of Adam and Eve left this beautiful garden of Europe and ventured, for some stupid reason, south. They landed in Africa, and it was in Africa where their beautiful white skins were blackened and made covered. And of course, you know, being away from the heart of civilization in Europe, their culture sort of wrenched into ruins. But climate theorists said, there's a cure. Anybody want to take a guess? Go north. Black people, go back up to Europe. Their skins will literally become white again. And therefore their cultures, they'll become beautiful again, their cultures will become civil again. And so climate theory was, and curse theory really debated up until a book by the name of The Origin of Species really ended that debate. It was a 400 year debate, right? With, to a certain extent, Christians taking both sides in certain types of ways, more so the side of climate theory.
One final question, and then we'll have on the second.
Yes, go ahead. I love your speech. I just have one simple question to ask you. Do you think that black people can be racist?
So it's a great question. And so I
say I don't.
I'm sorry?
Just for the record, I don't.
Okay. So, I study anti-black racist ideas. Racist ideas about black people. Racist ideas that suggest black people are lazy, black people don't work, black people are hypersexual, there's something wrong with black people. And entering into this text, you know, I thought that I was thinking that I was only going to chronicle white people who developed these ideas. And I found that even black people had developed and produced ideas that suggested that there was something wrong or inferior about black people. To give an example, probably the most harmful racist idea of the last 50 years is the idea that the black family is pathological. Mm-hmm. It really became a popular theory as a result of the Moynihan Report in 1965. Mm-hmm. It is the theory that justified the attack on welfare. It's the theory that justifies supposedly why black people commit more crimes, including in the book last year called The War on Cops. And this theory that the black family is pathological was created by a black scholar by the name of E. Franklin Frazier. In his famous book, The Negro Family in the United States. And Moynihan, whose theory and whose book has been roundly debunked and challenged as racist, cited E. Franklin Frazier throughout his book.
Yeah.
Now, so to me, anyone can say that there's something wrong or inferior about black people. Anyone, including black people. And I sort of found, you know, I not only sort of debunked, and demonstrated the ways in which all these ideas are false, I did find that there actually is one thing that's wrong with black people. And the only thing that's wrong with black people is that we think something is wrong with black people. And the only thing that's extraordinary about white people, you might want to take this, something is extraordinary about white people.
In the room behind me, there, we have a few snacks and beverages, but more importantly, you'll have an opportunity to get a book and get an autograph from Dr. Kendi before we break up and move in there. Please, let's give him one more round.